I want to say a very warm welcome to folks who have joined us here, listening and watching online. My name is Helen Pridmore, and I'm a member of the board of the Canadian New Music Network. Bienvenue à tous. Je suis membre du conseil d'administration pour le réseau canadien pour les musiques nouvelles. I live in Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, which is part of Treaty 6 territory, the traditional land of the Cree, Soto, Dene, Dakota, Lakota, Nakota, and Métis nations. CNMN brings together music and sound creators, producers, performers, educators, and listeners, offering resources and opportunities for mutual exchange and listening. Based in Chautauqua, Montreal, on unceded Indigenous land, of which the Kanyenkehaka Nation are the recognized custodians, CNMN's membership spans the territories of the many nations of Turtle Island. So I'm very pleased to introduce today's conversation on community, part of our activism series and part of conversations that emerged at our 14th CNMN forum, Listen Up, Tendez les Oreilles. Community is at the core of our organization. The CNMN primarily exists for networking to improve communication, understanding, and knowledge within the new music and sound community, and representation to do the same beyond our community and with an ever larger audience. La communauté est au cœur de notre organisation. Le Réseau canadien pour les musiques nouvelles existe en premier lieu pour le réseautage afin d'améliorer la communication, la compréhension et les connaissances au sein de la communauté des musiques nouvelles et du son, et pour la représentation pour faire de même au-delà de notre communauté et auprès d'un public toujours plus large. Leading today's conversation is Dr. Rebecca Keynes, an interdisciplinary artist and scholar. And Rebecca will tell you more about her work, and she will also tell you more about her colleagues who are joining us today. But we do welcome Giorgio Magnanensi and Louise Campbell and the PCM Hub, which Louise will also be discussing. So thank you for being here. Merci à tous. And over to you, Rebecca.
Thank you so much, Helen, and thank you to the Canadian New Music Network for this invitation. It's been a real pleasure. Before I talk a little bit more about who's here and what we're talking about, I just wanted to acknowledge where I am. I have just landed in Ontario on the territory of the Mississaugas and Haudenosaunee. And I'm also, this land that I'm on right now, even though we're virtually connecting, is subject to the Dish With One Spoon Wampum Belt Covenant, which is a really important agreement to live and to share the land equitably and peacefully. So we have a lot of work to be done if that's going to take place here and across the country. So I'm acknowledging that work and my place in that work. It's such a delight to lead this conversation today with these wonderful panelists. Let me introduce them and then we'll talk a little bit about what we're doing. So born and raised in Italy, Giorgio Magnanensi currently lives in Roberts Creek on the Sunshine Coast of British Columbia in Canada, and his diverse artistic practice includes composition, conducting, improvisation, sound art, circuit bending, and video art. And from the early 80s to date, he's been working as a composer, conductor, educator, and performer in Europe, Japan, Canada. He's the recipient of the Mayor's Arts Award 2017 in music. And he's the artistic director of the Vancouver New Music, also a laboratory at Art Society and a lecturer at the School of Music of the Vancouver Community College. Welcome, Giorgio.
Thank you so much, Rebecca, for having me tonight.
And Louise Campbell is a Montreal-based musician whose professional hats range from clarinetist to conductor, participatory arts facilitator to cultural mediator. As a performer, composer, and improviser, Louise seeks to interrogate and renew the ways in which we make music by creating works with everyone, regardless of age, ability, level of prior experience, or training. And her specializations include improvisation and creation with untrained, aka amateur musicians, improvised conducting, cross-disciplinary creation, collaborative processes, and public engagement. And she's toured as a performer, guest artist, and lecturer of improvised and composed music across Canada, the US, France, Germany, and Brazil. And you can check out her website at louisecampbell.ca to find out more. Welcome, Louise.
It's great to be here.
Thanks so much. And just so I can give you a little bit of grounding of who I am, I am a professor who's works at York University, and my research and practice is around communication. The concept for these thematic videos is that we would be able to share our work, and then with this conversation today, that we'll be able to kind of talk a little bit about the videos that we made for Forum 2021 and sort of give you a sense of them. We hope you've had a chance to watch the videos. If you haven't, you can watch them later, and we'll give you a little bit of a taste about what's happening in them. So I thought maybe we could start by just describing the videos, maybe in our own words. So maybe, I don't know who would like to start. Louise, would you like to tell us a little bit about the video that you made?
Sure. In the video that I made, I think it was kind of musings on the questions that you, Rebecca, sent to us, all based around the idea of what is community music and what is community, which I've thought a lot about that word for a very long time, because it can be a great signifier, and I think it can also be have a lot of issues with it. And so my understanding of community has changed a lot over the last, 20 to 30 years, and very significantly within the last 2 years, because I felt very much connected with my community and very disconnected with the various different communities that I feel a part of. So the video that I submitted was kind of me musing about this. And at the same time, very much recognizing that I'm not a video artist. And so I was a little bit tired at that time of being, you know, a Zoom box, a face on a screen. And so I took some video footage of the place that I was at the time, which was my mother's backyard, which has some beautiful, beautiful water that's very close to it. So for me, that was just water is a place where I go to listen and to really ground myself. And so it was a way to kind of help myself to kind of make these reflections on community music in a place where I feel very connected myself as well too.
And then you also helped curate a series of videos from the Hub. Would you like to talk a little bit about the Hub, maybe, so people understand that?
For sure. I'm also the project leader of the Participatory Creative Music Hub, which is a hub that the CNMN has been working on for about the last 2 years or so. It's an online resource that is meant to inspire and provide tools to anybody and everybody who wants to make music. So each of the projects that is part of the Hub, I think, really is a great indication of a certain group of people, community or any other word that you want to use, being creative together. And most of it is around music and sound, and sometimes it involves other art practices as well too. But it's really a matter of people getting together and being creative in the hopes that we can share that and inspire other people to be creative themselves as well too. So the few projects that I highlighted in that video seemed to me to really speak to the idea of community and what the various different kinds of ways we can think of communities and the way that people might feel a part of or perhaps not a part of a various different groups of people.
Thank you. And certainly, if you haven't already, please go and check out the Hub website and all of the incredible content that is building around this exciting kind of initiative. Hi, Georgia, would you tell us a little bit about what you did?
Yes, well, thank you so much. Well, this was a great opportunity for me to work on some ideas that also for me have been changing around the idea of the community in different ways. And the first thing that I thought when I was invited to do this one and discuss it, that community for me is a group of people that is able to live together and in doing so create the culture of the group. The culture itself is community making, and as such is a collective work, but rely also on the ability of everyone to be community in itself, because community is not just other people. In my personal perception, as a person living or a human being, I think there is community in the stones of my beach, and I love the stones of my beach a lot. So I started with that very simple idea, instigated by Huizinga, that the view that we take is that culture arises in the form of playing, is something that I wanted to just exercise myself as a sort of, you know, enhancing that idea. So simply, I started playing with rocks more and more in my day of isolation here on the coast. And I realized that that was extremely beautiful for me to regain this materiality and this resonance with this beautiful rocks, but also was allowing me to become a sort of a strange magnet for good and bad reason. As you can imagine, there's people like me going on the beach because in this area is beautiful. You have a space to escape. And some people would look at me and thinking of a bit of a cuckoo banging on rocks and sitting down and play with my beard. And some other were more curious. And the one that was invited to play with me, it was beautiful because I didn't have to say anything. I just I play some rocks. Let's play the rocks. Anyway, so that's kind of the main stimulus that brought me to that. Then surely, in doing so, you realize that all the effort we put to create opportunity for people and things to gather together in an energetic way are wonderful, but they are still needed to be rooted in something that is deeper than like a broadcasting of good energy. I don't know how to put it. Everything is that we do, I think, is valuable, and there are so many tools that we have at hand now. But you never see people so embodied in their own resonance with the others, and so actually becoming more themselves when they include these others. When they are like, for example, banging rocks together and play with that, so that the sound, the physicality, the materiality becomes so relevant and becomes a like an enriching experience in its pure, very simple behavior. And so that was a, you know, and I didn't want to speak so much, so I added some text which reflect upon this idea of behavior, especially because we think artistic work as an object or something that we create and serve to someone else. But for me, more and more becomes any things that emerge from a creative act is not a product, but is the behavior that is the relevant thing, is how that manifests itself. And so I think from a pedagogical point of view, from a personal point of view, from a communication point of view, there is lots I have to do about freeing myself and stay more with this idea so that I can be not too close or centered, but more expanded.
Thank you. That was beautiful. And I think introduced lots of ideas that you and Louise and I have talked about. Just to introduce a little bit of what I did in the video, after having really great conversations with Giorgio and Louise, I created a score that kind of, for me, was both a musical score and a set of kind of musings on the difficulties and wonderfulness of community. And I really thought through some of the projects I've done over the years and how, you know, what it is that held some of them together or what it is that kind of ran through them, because they were very different. And I think we all engage in very, very different communities during our lives. So I searched for kind of moments where I could, you know, connect to the work that you both do and that community engaged artists are doing, and created this score. So we thought we might use the score as a way to kind of continue our conversation. So I'm just going to share my screen and I'll share the images, and we'll just use each one as kind of a prompt to get us talking. So let me just share this. So this score, is a musical score for improvisers and organizers. It was originally a text work, and then I collaborated with an artist, Timmy Passy. So let me just go to the first question, and hopefully that can get us thinking. It was around entanglement. It was around how we create an entangled net that connects us to the communities that we work with and that we find joy in and connect to. So maybe Louise, I'll stop the share. You can talk a little bit about some of the groups that you've become entangled with in your work.
For sure. I mean, one of the groups that I think I've thought the most about in terms of community is a group that I've worked with for a number of years now called the Care Center. And over the course of the pandemic, we had a project in which it got really very much sidetracked at the very beginning of the pandemic for something that we were supposed to be doing in person, and it switched immediately online. So it was podcasting, and the idea was that I was going to go in and help people learn how to podcast their own stories. When it spun online, it was a little bit of a complication in some ways, just because many of the people in this center have severe physical disabilities and don't necessarily have, you know, digital dexterity. So that definitely is a challenge when you're far away, because I couldn't necessarily see how they were using their communication devices in order to actually communicate. So it was really quite amazing to watch this community go, basically, because there are a lot of people who very oftentimes are not able to really be, you know, there's many just barriers in the world. You know, it can be as simple as a curb, that when somebody is trying to go somewhere, a curb can stop them from entering a place. Whereas during this pandemic time, we used Zoom to connect with each other. And I felt very much welcomed into their circle of people. And, you know, very much like I feel like I'm a part of their family because of that experience that we had together. And we ended up making podcasts in a very different way than I'd anticipated. And it's beautiful because it's this community of people talking with each other and showing very much how much they care for each other. Mm-hmm. And it was very much, you know, done in a sense of like capturing of sound using cell phones or using the Zoom audio or descriptions of what people are hearing, so that we could all understand where each other was coming, where they were in this world, and using that to create an audio picture, an audio portrait of who we all were individually and collectively as a group. So that's, I think, a really lovely way that entangled kind of sound sounded for me. So that is really, for me, one of my favorite projects that I've ever done. And I think a lot of it had to do with how welcomed I felt, and to be able to see this connection and the care for all of the people that they had for each other for so long was just really a lovely thing.
Yeah, and I think, Georgia, the way you spoke about entangling yourself with the people on the beach and, you know, engaging, I think for all of us, it's also about, you know, acknowledging our own entanglement, right? I think some of the dangers of this kind of engagement is when the language becomes an idea of charity or sharing, or, you know, somebody from the center reaching out to other people, when actually we are deeply changed by what's occurring, right? And I feel like that's what you were speaking a little bit about there, Georgia, the kind of changing for you when somebody, you know, came and engaged with you in that space. Would that be right? Yeah.
Well, there are, thinking about, for example, going back to the graphic score idea, is how that actually can be reconceptualized too as like a sort of a allow the score to become a relationship in a way, and in that you know, expand that imagination that can allow to transform, even visionary transform, and enable different view on things, on people. Like I remember William Forsythe was a choreographer in American working in Germany, and he was talking about his dancer in terms of score. The body of a dancer is a score, and allow him to kind of imagine and envision synesthetically sound that are movement or figure and forms that evolve through a sort of a living score as a body of a dancer. But it's not a very abstract concept. It's just the things we actually see every day, either the wind in the forest or the movement of a large group of peoples or a flock of birds in the skies. But we externalize them because we can name them, you know, we can say, oh, the birds, or the forest, you know.
And I suppose that's partly what this kind of sounding with each other does, is create these kind of entanglements where things prompt new things that would never have happened, right? And I think you both mentioned improvising in your work has been really important. For me, it's certainly the way in which community engages, right? Is through these surprising moments, I guess, you know, things we weren't expecting that would prompt new things to be possible. I think that's what you were saying there, Louise, about being welcomed and something new coming out of that surprising welcome, I guess.
Yeah.
So, one second. I'm just going to share the next image because it's around quiet and silence. And I thought maybe that would be another thing to talk about because we talk a lot about making sound. But I think sometimes the silence is just as important. Full screen. So be quiet and let the lost sounds be reheard. If your sounds were the ones lost, there is a moment here for you. Maybe we can talk a little bit about silence in our work. I don't know who'd like to start.
Well, actually, I really love doing listening games with people. And there's not really any such thing as true silence. So when you actually take a moment just to listen, then you hear things that you didn't necessarily hear before. You know, like I've got a buzz that just started in some light that wasn't there 2 minutes ago. And something in the circuits just made it start to buzz. And I'm quite certain that each one of you has your own sound environment that is very unique to your space, unique to you, and unique to whatever environment you're in. So one of the things that I've done a ton over the course of doing a lot of workshops online is just simply asking people to sit and listen for 2 to 4 minutes without speaking, and then sharing what they heard. And it's quite amazing to me how much that creates a real understanding of where people are, what kind of situation they're in. You know, like if somebody's saying, my sibling's, you know, having a temper tantrum, or, you know, like I hear my father on a Zoom meeting, or I hear all kinds of traffic, or there's birds, or there's no birds, or, you know, it really does, it's very evocative what the sounds we have that are around us. And I find that starting that way helps us to better understand each other's contexts. And then the music that can come out of that feels more grounded in a way.
And I guess the beach was both noisy and silent, Giorgio.
Yeah, yeah. Similarly, I agree. I mean, it's difficult to talk about always. We are living a binary form already. So the beauty of whatever we are doing with our ear and sound and body and as is exactly that we can actually discover always more and more. And maybe silence, if you want to use that word, is actually the impossibility in itself, the most beautiful possibility of being in sound, where, you know, it's like the mu, the Zen void as a fullness at the same time, something we can really understand except allowing intuition to take care of that perception. And so I think even in regard of this very binary form of sound, silence, you know, soft and hard, or the categorization that we use in dynamic and in form is actually a very, very analytical way to look at something that have actually a sort of a creative quality. It's kind of a creature in itself. Like Francisco Lopez, who is a musician and electronic musician, and also an entomologist, studied insects for a long time, mentioned this idea of sound as a sort of an autonomous entity, a creature of which ontology we cannot really refer, because exist is ephemeral, but it does have a sort of a strong energetic presence that we still don't totally grasp. And so the sound of the stones is the same. Maybe it goes back to ancestral resonances in our psyche. I have no idea, but even the touch and the people touching them, just being aware they're doing something. So again, a behavior that is brought to a sort of a focus and attention become something that reveal possibility that they were not thought before. So similar to a sonic meditation per se, but without needing to be instructed upon, but just allow for something to happen. So that too, how you create community, who knows really, but foster and possibility for a space to allow for something to happen that may morph and transform or reveal itself as such. Other than that, recipes are pretty slim.
I was thinking of silence in terms of also, you know, who gets to speak and whose voice gets to be heard, and how do we, you know, maybe drop down the voices that always get heard so there's more space for the ones that don't. Because that, you know, power doesn't disappear just because we're being creative. And so it's very hard to know how to best manage that kind of, you know, moments where somebody who's had a lot of power in their life and is very used to being heard, you know, takes up all the space, you know, which I know I do at times too, right? It's very easy to have happen. So how do we create structures that allow those lost sounds and those quiet moments and those folks that don't get to speak, you know?
Yeah, I think you touch a very important point, at least very critical for me at this time. You know, just the question about language and communication in general. It's very difficult to tell people do this and that, and so you learn to do that, and they do it. Then instead, not saying anything, do something, and have someone that just embody the same gesture is like a completely different approach. It's like is like mother and son, you know. It's like the inarticulated singing or cuckooing to kids as a message from a distance, as someone say that is still. Is energetic, is a creature, is tactile in spite of the fact that is sonic and so many other things. And how we translate that in a way that we can actually regain that sensuousness, as you know, of you know, the beyond that rational brain, European brain.
European brain. Louise, I know in your work there's a lot of silences and moments where people get to be heard for the first time or hear themselves for the first time, and they can be really powerful moments, I think.
Yeah, and I think a lot of what I try to do as a facilitator is find a way to make sure that everybody is comfortable with finding a way to contribute. Mm-hmm. And that way to contribute is going to be different for every single person. And for me, improvisation is a huge thing. We mentioned it before. But if you're giving somebody exactly what to do, you're not necessarily allowing them to speak in their own voice. And I do work with a lot of people who aren't trained professional musicians. And so I need to make sure that I'm setting up a context in which they can contribute what they want to be contributing. And it also makes me think actually of the care center again, where there are a lot of people who are nonverbal and again, don't have necessarily, like, it's just not a possibility for many of the people there to play a clarinet. Like, the clarinet is just not built for their hands. But we can make instruments that are built for their hands so that person can play their own music with them. Mm-hmm. It makes me think a lot also of Chelsea Jones and Helen Pridmore's Hub project Helen, correct me if I'm wrong. I'm losing the title of it. It's a beautiful project. You really have to go and check out, because it's really about allowing people to sound their voice in whatever way that they have. And it's another community that has a number of people who are nonverbal as well as verbal, and finding a way to create vocal soundscapes together. And so having this form of improvisation that allows space for people to contribute what they have to contribute, I think is a way to make sure that people who want to speak can, in whatever way that they have.
I always remember working with Rick Kotowicz and Amanda Shenstead at Wiskana Rehabilitation Center in Regina in Saskatchewan. I think I might've told this story in the video, I can't remember. But we were playing a word at a time story, and there were folks who were nonverbal and who were spelling out words on all sorts of ways that they were sharing their word. But there would be this great moment where there was a pause, a long and beautiful pause, where we would all lean in to see whether somebody had a word they wanted to share. If they did, was it going to come to them? you know, and this moment of everybody holding that space right there for as long as it needed to be held for is a really significant moment for me, I think, in terms of silence, right? In terms of it took as long as it took, and sometimes it took a really long time, but the group sort of all held that space, you know, waiting for that beautiful, whatever it was, sound sometimes, a word to kind of appear.
I love that sense of waiting, because it feels to me like that really is what the arts and being human is about that sense of everybody being together. And in that sense of silence of what you're talking about, everybody is listening and everybody is there for whatever's about to happen. So that's actually a thing that I really love. And that's when I know that a group has reached a certain level of cohesion and a certain level of understanding of how we're working together. And, you know, it happens in different ways for every single group and every single project. There's always, you know, the really boisterous, energetic kind of chaos that happens, which I love too. And there's also this wonderful kind of sense of everybody listening together that can also create those beautiful moments of silence.
I'm just going to share the next image here. So the next image is around joy, which we talked a lot about as being something that we that makes us want to do this work and be in these worlds that we're in. So experience the massive joy in the ecstatic bliss of other people and your sounds together. And so I just thought maybe we could share a few moments of those kind of joyful moments. I know there's many, many that stand out for me where, it, you know, I think humans are designed for joy. And how do we foster and create that, you know, and when does it happen is always so surprising, right? What do you think, Georgia? Moments of joy? I feel like this might have come out when you were talking about bliss and connection when we first started talking about community.
Well, there is, I mean, as you said, I think we are prone to joy and being together and really enjoy that connection. I think the cases of inability of sharing community are probably more pathological than not. I mean, just due to, because reality that I think we see it, people like to congregate and all the, you know, all the things we are doing that mean a lot to us are the things that we can share together, from cooking a dinner or a lunch to going together to witness something, to do something together, to build something together, to play together, and so forth. Not that I don't treasure my own personal space and time, is a continuous osmotic movement between one and many. And again, I think the scholastic model may be good, but it's still too regimented by very hierarchical system of thoughts and especially binded by a public building and box that, you know, box people in a kind of a closed space. I always felt in a sort of a jail situation when I was a kid in Italy, with a cross from one side and a fascist teacher on the other side. And, you know, pretty strong imprinting in that regard about what is a community in that regard. And so, yeah, there are moment in which joy is the only way you can be infectious in some way, you know, without joy is not necessarily like noisy in a sense of disturbing, you know, can be a very, very calming state. Joy for me, even just banging a stone, it was an extremely joyful moment. And if you transform that, again, thresholds are very different today, it's many different people. So,
yeah. It does make me think about how blind we are to what joy can look like for different people. I just wonder in our work when we are missing joy because we think it looks a certain way or we are looking for certain markers and maybe they're cultural too, right? And I know, for example, you know, some of the work I've done where, you know, communication strategies are so different or languages are not there, or, you know, systematic inequality is causing massive problems. And, you know, it's very hard sometimes to recognize that joy is like a survival technique, right? And doesn't always look the same. So I don't know if you agree, Louise, in your work, but It's I'm constantly surprised at how people manage to make joy in situations that you just think, how can you do that?
Well, I think, massive joy, what a great phrase. just making music with people and being creative is just fun. It's super fun. And when you work with people who don't necessarily have that every day of their life or every week or perhaps not always in their life, like for years, it's an act of joy. And finding a way to show somebody that they don't have to sound like their favorite singer or they don't have to be like some virtuosic musician or other, they can make their own music and sound in their own way. That can be incredibly joyful for people. And I love that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I really love getting to see this person who's just like, for the first time, being able to make music and loving it. It doesn't take a lot, honestly. Like, it just takes, allowing people and setting up a situation in which they feel like they can. And sometimes, sometimes it's funny, because I think of the times when I've been able to witness such beautiful joy in other people has sometimes been when the power dynamic has been totally flipped. So one of the things that I really love doing is setting up like an improvised conducting situation in which we learn some really basic kind of gestures that are quite intuitive. Like if I go like this, that means you play, right? If I go like this, then the person over here plays, stop, very, very basic kind of gestures so that everybody knows what we're talking about, but then ask if anybody else wants to conduct. And it doesn't matter if it's, a 10-year-old in front of their peers or a 104-year-old in front of their peers, all of a sudden they get to be in charge.
Mm-hmm.
And they get to have some kind of sense of how this next moment is going to be shaped. And I've, 8-year-olds, people in school, like the teacher is always the authority. So changing that kind of authority and having a slightly more flat playing field, I think can really give people a sense of yeah, it just comes out as incredible joy and wonderful, wonderful improvisations. Especially given that we're all using the same basic kind of gestural language. It's like this, that, a couple other ones that everybody's always allowed to make up their own gesture that means something musically for everybody else to follow. And you just go for hours that way. And again, the thing of like subverting that kind of power dynamic, it's not that that one person becomes the authority for the entire time. It's that it's shared. So who else would like to come in and conduct? Okay, that was cool. Wasn't that different? How interesting. And who else would like to conduct? Maybe we could have two conductors at once. And then we end up having something where individuals can really have a real contribution in what they're doing and show their individuality and try things and see what works and see what they like. And that's I think, where we get out of this kind of right-wrong thinking, good-bad, virtuosic, non-musician, all of that kind of stuff, where you just kind of, everybody has their own individuality that they can contribute.
Well, you're doing an extremely virtuosic work anyway, Louise, because in a sense, the virtuosity of a virtue, the quality you are putting that commitment is great. And I think that, you create a listener that are ready to go and finally feel kind of comfortable in front of a group that usually say, oh, these improviser, crazy people, I don't understand what they're doing. Well, reality that we are all doing the same thing pretty much, it's just a question of, how skills or technicalities, if you want. But this is great. What you're talking about, I totally respect your approach in that regard, because it's not just activism in itself, it's like full of joy and just the ability to regain people to a certain level of clarity in that, which is wonderful.
I was thinking about learning through joy when you were speaking there, Louise, about the idea that, again, like the things I've learned about the world from people who live in it differently to me, the way in which, when the pandemic happened, for example, I was working with community groups up in the Yukon, and some of the folks were living in assisted living housing. They have sensory differences and they were, learning to play and do sound with me. And then pandemic happened and we left some things up there for them to use, iPads, for example. And you know, they picked up the iPads and they made their own videos about what the pandemic meant for them, because the equipment was there and they could use it in their house. And those videos taught me so much about how to adapt, what it's like to constantly have your choices taken away from you, what it is like to, I mean, they're virtuosic improvisers in their daily lives, right? They have to improvise all day, every day to just, you know, get anything done. And so as improvisers, we have massive amounts to learn from them, because their lived experience is so deep in the thing that we do as our creative practice, as our scholarly practice. So I just feel like when you spoke there, I thought, oh, there's something about learning through joy, but, you know, learning is so much more possible in those moments than it is in moments of coercion or moments of hierarchy or moments of, like requirement, right? Yeah. It seems like joy is conductive to community actually sharing knowledge with each other, right?
Yeah,
for sure. And I totally second your idea that, you know, about the creativity of various different people. You know, with the care center, the people who are both there as clients, the people with severe physical disabilities, and the caregivers are hands down the most creative group of people that I have ever met. And it happens every day, because every day brings something new. Maybe somebody's coming in and their body is just not responding in the way it did the day before. Maybe the technology isn't quite working the way it was 2 minutes ago. And it's all about finding creative, fun, joyful ways of connecting with each other. And, you know, one of my favorite stories of the stories of care was the way that the executive director, Olivia Cannell, facilitated having connections with people, with two people who were living in long-term care centers. And the doors were shut at that time because it was very early on in the pandemic and it was meant for health reasons. One of them had left his communication device at the care center, so he had no way to communicate. The other woman has a very sophisticated method of communication that the caregivers in her home simply didn't have time to understand her, to learn how she communicated. And so she was without communication for at least a month and a half. And so Olivia's task as being, you know, the major link between these people and the outside world was to figure out a way to, you know, have fun with these people at a distance and find a way to communicate. And so with a man who had left his communication device at the care center, she would call him on a phone, and he was able to press the phone once, beep, for yes, and twice, beep, beep, for no. So they had huge conversations based on beep and beep, beep. Like, incredible, super fun. Mm-hmm. And with the other woman, for her, it was again a matter of calling using old technology, the phone, and we ended up making musical gifts for her. And so she was somebody who just, she loves Metallica, like absolutely loves Metallica. Now, I play clarinet, yes, with guitar pedals, but I really can't do Metallica. So Tim Brady was actually part of this project. And so I asked him, it's like, Tim, could you do something, you know, inspiration from Metallica? And he did this really awesome short piece, short improvisation that then we played for this woman in her care center. And she got to hear this music that somebody from outside who she didn't know showed her that he was thinking of her while she was in her care center. And so, like, this is just a few of the examples of how creative this group of people were in connecting with each other, in showing their care for each other, showing their support. And that, I think, is just, like, it's incredible. Like, really, for, you know, as far as our group of people here coming together through the CNMN, yes, we have a certain kind of creativity. But I think learning from other groups of people who are creative in ways that maybe we aren't necessarily pushed to be, there's so much to be learned from that. And I think a lot of it too is just that joy, that sense of play of what can we find out, what can we discover, what can we do together.
And that curiosity, I think, drives so much, right? If we can be curious.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I'm just going to share the next image, because it might take us in a slightly different direction, because it's about walls and barriers. So this is take the sound walls down and for support each other's beginnings. And this, I think, came out of thinking about systematic major injustices that are incredibly endemic and aren't going away with one small community creative project, right? What do we do with those walls? What do we do with them? How do we get them down? How do we support things we haven't seen before that we don't even know what they are? So it's really a harder question, I think. Maybe it's all to do with joy. Maybe joy will do the work for us. But, you know, what do we do with those barriers? And where have you engaged and hit those walls in your work?
Well, oh, sorry. Maybe
please, go ahead, Giorgio.
Go ahead, Giorgio.
For example, as you know, I'm artistic director of this very old organization in Canada, Vancouver Music, that's going to be 50 years old in not too long. And usually artistic direction implies an attitude that is, you know, open-minded and researching and then choosing whatever is best. Reality is that going back to a first encounter in Canada many, many, many years ago with someone that became a wonderful friend, that they told me, you know, around here, everyone on the street will know something that you don't know. And which is, yeah, very, very true and very humbling at the same time. And so at this point, for example, one thing that I've been trying to do to make an effort towards as much as inclusive and fostering an approach that kind of bring with joy a sense of a, what can I say, harmony in a very or harmonization in a very utopistic but at least possible way, is like don't decide too much about what I want or I don't want to do, and just ask people what you want to do, and okay, just go and do it. Because reality that in these couple of years, lots of people, especially in the arts community, but not only, have been feeling really isolated, unable to express themselves, be themselves, or be with their community. And again, I guess it's an interesting moment that can be transformational in a way too, in terms of what we do, like artist, musician, dancer, sculptor, everyone engaged with artistic creation. We don't have to become all activists in a way, or you don't have, you know, the politics of all this is very important, but doesn't have to be in a way force upon idea of being a creative person in the community, even just allowing for a certain kind of, you know, a certainty that the value that we do is recognized and is the value of imagination, like it add the two universal value we want to be recognized in general, which is the one that we are trying to, you know, face and finally resolve. I think is a long, long transformation, but it's happening for many reasons. The crisis is important in its own way, just to allow for that to reveal. Not that I'm saying I'm happy that we have COVID, but, you know, I try to see the advantages instead of the disadvantage of a situation like that. And so for artistic work, so yeah, allow as much as possible resources that we have in this country, which are huge for arts at this moment, to just be equally distributed in way they're not always discriminated from longer or shorter CVs or longer or shorter list of prizes and so forth. So that's what I'm trying to do, just very humbly in trying to, you know, I'm lucky to be in a situation where I can allow for these kind of things to happen. I don't see anything illegal in renouncing to authority so much at this particular time and day. So,
I think they're both very important points. The idea of asking people what they want to do rather than deciding what it is they should do, and also supporting things that, you know, don't fit the boxes that we are used to asking things to fit. That seems like two possible ways. But what do we do when these walls are so big? Like, we have so much settler colonial harm in this country, right? That is like still going. So we've got Indigenous colleagues who are trying to do work against all of the odds. We have such an inaccessible, infrastructure. If your body or your mind is at all not what, you know, a very, very tiny, narrow idea of what it should look like. So I don't know if you have solutions, Louise, that have you seen working, of how do we kind of get into those walls? Because you know, I agree, we don't have to all be, you know, marching on the streets, but the systematic work has to happen too, I think. Otherwise, how do we fix some of these things that are so big?
That's a huge question, Rebecca.
Yeah, a little tiny one, you know.
I mean, there's two things that come to mind. First is, I guess, some of my approaches that I take as an organizer. And so when I'm in a position like being project lead for the hub, some of it is like, you know, getting my elbows out and trying to make space for people who don't necessarily always have, aren't always put in the limelight. And that has been definitely a real focus in the hub, is to try and make sure that that it's a space for people to be able to use and populate with their own kinds of projects and inspiration, but very much coming from various different sectors. So I spent a lot of time researching the, you know, what's going on across Canada, and very specifically, you know, putting out a call out in general, but also going and approaching various different people and saying, would you be interested in being part of this hub? Is there a way that I can help you? And trying to make people feel like it was possible for them to contribute, and also dedicating some of my hours, like some of my paid hours as the hub lead, to help them do that. So if, for example, someone has not great tech skills and is super intimidated by having to create media content, which they don't usually do if they have a purely acoustic practice, maybe I can help them in order to find ways to do that easily. And then I upload things onto the hub myself, or I walk them through it so that then maybe they can be a little bit more comfortable with doing it themselves the next time. So there were a number of projects like that that had various different sort of like roadblocks to contributing that I very much kind of went, okay, this is important. This person and this project should be a part of the hub, and I can help that happen this way. Mm-hmm. And that's really a question of, you know, being in the organizing position. There's another organization I work with called Artists Inspire, where we have a really interesting roster of artists, and we've made a huge effort to make sure that it's very, very, people come from all different walks of life, very diverse. Because we always have schools asking us, you know, can you send us an artist who will speak to LGBTQ2+ issues? So we have people that we know are comfortable addressing those issues through art, who are themselves, they identify as LGBTQ2+. We have other people who are trained as social workers and psychologists and are also teaching artists. And so we have schools coming to us saying, we need help with mental health. You know, like, okay, so we can pair you up with this person that we know can address that. Same thing for people, you know, for particular schools who have very high proportions of BIPOC students. Maybe they need to see somebody who reflects their own image in the mirror. Or maybe there's a school where there's a lot of issues with discrimination. Maybe if there's an artist who is willing to do this, who is BIPOC, we can send that person there, only if they're comfortable, of course. So it's a matter of having a conversation with the various different partners and finding a way to facilitate the access. So I think that's, you know, in this my small way of an organizer, that's how I try to address these things.
And
I think as an the other half of this is me being the facilitator, and I do the work that I do because I love it. Like, it's out of deep curiosity for what I do. It's not out of activist first conviction, you know, and I think a lot of other people will see it as being activist, but that's not my primary goal necessarily. But I know there are probably some kinds of, you know, results that come out of that, perhaps. But it's really out of, you know, just deep curiosity about how other people experience the world. And, you know, with, again, the care center, the woman who loves Metallica, when I started to understand how she communicates, I realized it's like, well, she explained to me, like, she taught me how to read her eyes. And the system that she uses is called bliss communication, where she'll look at eight various different places. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And each one of those things, you get two pairs of numbers. And then you have a graph. And you have two numbers that you read on top, two numbers at the side, and then that goes to a word that she's saying. So as soon as I went 0 to 8, we can make numbers mean notes. Like, we can make music together. That's no problem. You know, so it was just like, well, of course I have to come back next year. Me and Yota need to make music together. And then from there, you know, I got to know another woman whose name is Rachel. I'm working with her right now, who uses an eye gaze system in order to communicate. And it's really interesting getting to know Rachel. She's just a wonderful person, very sarcastic. And there are days when her body will function for herself and she can communicate very, very easily. And then other days where it's just not happening. So in that case, like what she's doing is she's using her painter on her communication tool to create graphic scores. And I'm on the other side of the Zoom screen playing, and we're starting to develop a little bit of a language that I can understand what she's looking for, what she wants. And just today, actually, we discovered this kind of thing that is built into her painter that changes color based on sound. And so it's really a curiosity of like starting to understand how she engages with the world, how she communicates, and going like, there's a painter on her communication system? Well, we can do scores together. So like that on, you know, the very personal level, you know, that I think, I hope, is making a difference for that one individual human.
And I feel like what a lot of, we talk about as, I don't know, socially engaged, community-based people in the world who are in community. I don't know what language you use to talk about yourself, but for me, that work is that work because I'm always translating and bridging and administrating and supporting. And that work is my art practice, along with the sound, along with the pitches, along with the whatever else, the work of organizing, of supporting, of bridging, of trying to find the right person to go with the right other person, of seeing like, oh my God, Giorgio does really cool things. Louise is wanting someone to do that. Wouldn't you, you two should talk to each other. That work is my passion. And that is what excites me about this kind of work. And I think it's a creative palette. It's a way of seeing possibility. And that gets me up in the morning, right? And like you said, it's not because I, you know, there's a political goal, although I do believe community will help us solve a lot of problems. It's a joy in that creative practice of bridging and translation and connection that I think gets lost. I think it's invisible. And I think sometimes musicians, for example, will see technique and not see the design of the project that led to the possibility of that technique, right? So I don't know if that you agree with that, but.
I agree. Yeah. I agree totally. And I think that, you know, creative energy manifests itself in a way, possibly fluid form. I mean, we are always, if we are in touch with creative spirit, you are creative anyway. And then the behavior is the important things. The behavior is not about the politics is good if it's referred to the real polis, the community, you know, the real world. The politics that we think now is just bull, you know. Sorry, let's leave it there. You know, it's like it doesn't seem to go anywhere. And so, yeah, absolutely. And I think that I don't know, idea of composition or organization. I mean, you have to be creative to navigate this this terrain in a way like you know, Louise with these women, with this situation in which we find ourselves facing inability even of our language or to manifest or to relate. And mm-hmm. So that's another, again, a very strong issue. We may have ideas that are really resonating. We use words that are not similar, but I think just if we start moving together, we'll find ways that harmonize people in ways that we don't know, because I think there is a strong barrier that is given by this, again, assumption that because I can speak, I can articulate ideas, allow me to have a sense of I can understand. Apprehension and understanding are two different things. Mm. And I think I understand a lot of things, but may not really be in touch with all of them in ways that I think, you know. So anyway, for me, it's very important from a pedagogical point of view. What I'm going to do to share these things with the community that is around me, the place I'm living in, as much as possible, supporting joys and fun, but at the same time, try to exchange idea, get to know other things myself. For me, moving to Canada has been a long trip into unknown territories of many kinds. So, and my curiosity is still there. Still
me too.
It's a huge country.
Yeah, I feel that too.
Why you want to travel somewhere else? I mean, I don't know this country at all. And moreover, in this situation, it's such a beautiful part of the world for all the aspect of these tensions and ideas. There is, you know, I came to Canada thinking that Canada had at that time a sort of a revolutionary spirit of possibility, because coming from Italy, all this idea of, even the idea of multiculturalism, which, you know, now we are kind of revising on a different, I mean, you know, oh, interesting. We have mainly racism in our own country, you know, north and south, you know, and so forth. And many other things, the soundscape project, idea of Mary Schaefer, the quality of the space from a natural point of view, geographical point of view, and so many beautiful things to work with.
It makes me think about observing what's there before you start, right? Whether it's with our ears or our eyes or our bodies. I just think of so many times in projects across my life, you know, community projects across my life, where the most beautiful work happened when I was accompanying the nurse on the shift for half the day, so that we could get a sense of what actually happened, so we knew where things could fit, you know, or where I, you know, cleaned the toilets at the community center in Northern Ireland because no one else could do it. And that is something I could do, you know, that's something I could do that would actually contribute to that person who was doing amazing work, not having to do it themselves, you know. And in those kind of observing what's happening moments of making 100 cups of tea or cleaning, packing up a pile of chairs, I feel like we start to see what's there, and then we've got a chance of supporting it, right? And I think, Louise, you were talking about, you know, we're learning about this communication system and then being like, oh, now we can do things, right? But you had to learn about it first. You had to see it first, I think. Yeah.
Well, I think it was my learning too.
That's right.
It was very much my learning, because the people in the care center, they know how it works, you know? And so if I were to come in, you know, as being the great artist who knows what to do, I would have missed a massive opportunity.
Yeah,
both for myself and for the other people.
And I think that sometimes I have, right? Where I've come in with something and thought, this is something I can offer. And it's taken me ages to realize, you know, that isn't actually what was needed in this space at all, right? And I think if you're not careful, like the not observing and the not listening and the not spending time in a place gets in the way of anything then possibly happening, right?
For sure. It makes me think of a project that I did in the Magdalen Islands, where I live in Montreal, and I'd never been to the Magdalen Islands before. And I was very much brought there because the community was in a real series of crises. They had some terrible, horrific events that had happened over the course of the previous years. And they needed, they were hoping that art could help them to just come together in a more positive way. And so when I was preparing to go there, I was just trying to think of like ways in, because I knew that it was a residency in a school that was from pre-K until grade 11, and they had a total population of 45 kids. So multi-age classrooms, very small, kids who'd known each other from birth until, you know, grade 11. And so I was trying to figure out, I knew they didn't have a music program at all. I knew that their community has a very strong singer-songwriter tradition, but only certain families play music. So I had to figure out a way to introduce myself to people. And I started barking up the wrong tree entirely. Completely. And it took the woman who was my liaison to kind of go like, no, that doesn't happen here. The history is not there. I've looked into it, that's not the place to go. It's like, okay, all right, let's try something else. And just really like throwing out what my plan was and just going, okay, so can you introduce me to your place? I want you to think of one of your favorite places to be. And I want you to, we did a visual arts project. So you get coffee filters and spray bottles and washable markers. It's like, think of three colors that you have in your favorite place. And I want you to just draw them all over this coffee filter. and then spray them with water, and they all spread all over the place and become these really beautiful kind of kaleidoscopic kind of works. Okay, so now it's dry. I want you to write down a few of the sounds that you hear in your favorite place. And then from there, without me even asking, people started to tell stories. And so from those stories, it became actually a podcast that was all about a very devastating storm that had happened the November previously that was really quite frightening for some of the younger students, because they lost power, they lost internet, they were really like, it was, everything was down for a good period of time. And they created this entire podcast. We went out and did field recordings to create the environment of the podcast. And so that was a great example where it's like, I came in with an idea, wasn't working. I had my own preconception of something, and what we ended up doing at the end was so much more interesting, and I think so much more valuable to them and to me as a person who was learning than what I had originally thought we could do together.
I totally resonate with that story. And, you know, it's one of the hardest things to admit that you don't know, that you've made a mistake, that it isn't the right way to go. And, you know, I think I spoke about this in the video too, that I had done a project around soundscape and listening in Guelph, and it was connected with communities in Northern Ireland that I'd work with in Australia, and I knew everyone really well. We had a great time. It was really good. Felt really happy about it. Met a woman who was working up in Northern Ontario who said, oh, you should totally do something like that up here. And I was like, yes, I should. And I, you know, write an email to someone I don't know, and I say, hey, you want to do a project together? And I get a grant. And then I realized, A, the woman I connected with didn't really know folks up there. B, I don't even know folks up there. What am I doing? So it's like a massive mistake. I had this grant and these communities that didn't know me at all. And so it was like, you know, 2 years of trying to work out what would be useful. I know I put a grant in for sound art. I was like, do you have a radio station? Maybe there's some bands who need help. Maybe, you know, and because they're a generous community and wonderful, we found ways where sound could actually be useful. You know, so they were trying to track, it's a First Nations, a collection of First Nations communities that were dealing with development that was taking away land. And they were trying to prove their land ownership so that they could stop the development. And they were using video cameras. They had massive amounts of video footage they didn't know what to do with, and it was not really working. And a whole bunch of sound recorders, and suddenly they could get in and get people's stories, connect to people's histories, record the singing, record the person talking about the trap lines. And it was private. You weren't in someone's house with a camera, you know, and it became useful. And there was like, thank God I found a way that sound art can be useful, right? And then we can talk about creativity, and we ended up making things that were, they made beautiful things, and we made stories together, and all sorts of things happened. But again, that kind of massive mistake of thinking, I know what I'm doing, I've done it before, you know, it'll work this time. And realizing, oh my goodness, I'm Australian, these are First Nation communities, like, I just come to Canada, what the hell do I know about any of this, right? And just starting right at the beginning, like meeting people, hanging out, having really, really strong coffee, like trying to find a way that we could make sense of this together. Just, you know, it had to go backwards and start the beginning. I think very similar to your story, Louise, right? How do we find the right way? And I think you're talking about listening. You listened, right?
It was a good lesson, honestly.
Yeah, me too.
A really, really good lesson for me.
And it probably kind of segues really well to our last slide. So let me just share that. So this one, I guess, is what you and I had to do. We had to stop and we had to start again, and in a better braided resonant way. And the reason I use the word braided is because I was reading Elwood Jimmy's piece on braiding, which is talking about Indigenous and non-Indigenous ways of knowing and how we get them to talk to each other if we're really going to make change, structural change. And braiding was a metaphor in that book that's really useful and makes us think about how we put together different worldviews. So how do we stop, start again in a better and braided way? And also this idea of resonance, which we all use as a word, I think, in creative and critical ways, to mean how do we respond and relate to this world that we're in? How do we break things down through sound? How do we build things up through sound? So how do we stop and how do we start again? I guess we started talking about that already. But I don't know if you have thoughts on this, on stopping and starting.
I think honestly, how to stop is you just stop.
you just finally stop. You just realize it needs to stop.
Yeah, I mean, I work with a lot of groups of people who aren't just going to go with you for the sake of going with you.
Yeah, me too.
So, like, it's so deadly obvious when something that you're proposing is not going to work. You're just like, okay, that's not happening. You know, like, it really, I work with a lot of people who don't necessarily have a lot of agency in their lives, you know, so it's not a matter of somebody doing something because they want me to feel good about myself, you know, like, it's just, that's just not the people that I generally tend to work with, you know, so, like, really, I get pushback, major pushback from people if they're not into what I'm doing, and so I just stop, and oftentimes it is a matter of trying to find the right questions to ask them, as Giorgio mentioned at the very beginning, what it is that they're interested in and what they want to do. And then that's where the restarting comes again.
I'm just thinking about mistake, right? The creativity that's inherent in mistake, right? Mm-hmm. The possibility that happens when you let a mistake sit. Is that something, Giorgio, you think about?
Well, a mistake is a recontextualization. It's not that to be seen as a failure all the time. Mm-hmm. It's more a reassessment. And I guess we go through that, especially when we try really to face difference as a value and not as an obstacle to, you know, always try to overtake. And in doing so, I mean, I personally have lots of, you know, come from a country like mine is great, but it's also so enslaving in a form of thinking that you have to kind of really find ways to get rid of it. And yeah, so stop looking back, maybe believe to your dreams and believe in your own intuition a lot. And, you know, time ago, I would be more suspicious in talking to young people, artists bringing stuff to my office. So I say, oh, great. I mean, there are people there like productive, they're doing stuff. So really just to see, experiment with that as much as possible. If there is no other way to foster a certain free form of, we talk about freedom, free improvisation, free this, free that. Okay, well, let's stop talking about it and just be free, you know, in a way, kind of exercise that freedom and start with your imagination, you know, like and I think for me is also, okay, I can do so much. I start with the place I live, the community I live, small footprint. Now with Zoom, maybe slightly larger footprint, great, but it's different. You know, I treasure still the physicality, the presence, the resonance that happened there. I mean, I love technology. I love electricity, maybe not the way it's produced, but I don't like a screen, you know, like us today. I mean, it's been so much and too much. So I really want to foster as much as possible safe way to get together. And, you know, I think just occupy more spaces outdoor, just be more. We in the city of Vancouver finally becomes a bit more maybe rigid. We managed to get some permission and some support to bring people outside and banging in statue and buildings and produce sonify the city in different ways. And if the city's on board, we're gonna, you know, go massively into orchestral mode.
Nice, very nice. I guess I also was thinking about stopping as a country, stopping as a nation, right? As a structure, because it failed so many times. Maybe some of these things have to stop. And we have to take them seriously, the idea that they need to stop. And I also, I guess, when I was thinking about that, I thought a lot about how people had reached their toleration point, right? Where Black Lives Matter was like, enough is enough, right? We need to stop right now. This has to stop. Or Me Too, you know, we've got to stop. This has to stop. This behavior has to stop.
Yeah.
And so as artists, I feel like, you know, we talk a lot about productive and creative and building, but I also think we have work to do to disrupt, to stop, to change the direction, to insert, you know, and how do we do that with our communities, right? Because I think, you know, I come from Australia where there's a long tradition of this, what they call community cultural development. So government funded cultural work with artists. but a lot of it is so celebratory and so, you know, it's about doing government's work for them, but doing it in a creative way, right? They need to get their health plan, and so you're an artist, you can make people feel better about it. That's not what we should be doing, you know? And so how do we do things that are not celebratory, I guess, is my question. How do we do things that might be angry or disruptive or, you know, I don't know, frustrated, and let them be creative too?
Yeah, transform the, you know, the idea, the excellence always referred to this idea, romantic idea or sentimental idea of beauty or beautiful things, and more like the, as you said, is that there is joy in that too. There is a positive attitude that they reassert a principle and idea, and you have to do it the way you say. Absolutely, it's not in a violent way, but with presence, not as expecting that things will transform, will adapt to, as you say, the stop and restart is kind of a call that everyone seems to hear, but it's difficult to, we're so entangled in the structure we live in, enslaved by money and taxes and labor and work. It's complicated. And I think it's just, and the more people that in the, like, you know, people that work in a creative way or in institution or in school organization are talking about it and making, you know, more something like the Canadian Music Network has been doing, just really putting together this energy. It's not so much about traveling here and there now. It's just about really consolidating a level of strength and awareness of all these different energy and forces that are around that make feel you a bit more confident in maybe in going forward, you know, not feeling so isolated yourself. There is solidarity, and I think that should reinforce our action and be in touch, exchange ideas, share them, you know, just, I know we do it all the time, but I really treasure this moment of communication and connection. So, so thank you again for sharing all these things together. It's wonderful, inspiring.
Well, that's a lovely, lovely way to maybe open up and see if there's anyone watching who had any feedback or questions. And a reminder that if you haven't, to watch the thematic videos we created and to continue the conversation and the activism and the work of building community, of challenging it when it's wrong and it needs to come down, of using art to do connection and beauty and disruption all at once. So please, you know, I know we'd love to stay in touch if people watch the videos and have thoughts and want to get in touch with us as well to keep the conversation going. But we have a few more minutes now if anybody who's watching live wants to ask anything or respond at all. Hi, Ellen.
Hi. I think I just want to say how inspiring and brilliant you all are. You know, really... humbled by the work that you're doing and the way you speak about it. And I think it's so important. Yeah. And the lessons that you talk about having learned the hard way. I think I've learned a few of those lessons myself. And I don't know that you ever get perfect at this, right?
That's the hardest lesson for me. Was learning that no model that I'd used before was going to perfectly work for the next thing. Yeah. That you had to just start again every time, and that has to be right. Sure, I train and I learn and I bring all that with me, but it's maybe not relevant. I might have to throw it all out and start again. And that, I guess, is where improvising helps, right? We bring all the training in, and then something happens that doesn't need any of it. We have to let it go somehow, right? Yeah. And find something else. So it is unfortunate that we can't feel comfortable and be like, I got this. It doesn't work that way. And it wouldn't be interesting to me if it did. But at the same time, it's terrifying sometimes when you realize, wow, there's things I've done before that just don't apply here. I have to come up with something else, something new. Oh, thanks.
Well, thank you, Ellen. Likewise, you have been... a very important and energetic figure and mentors in all this discourse. So it's great to have you with us today.
It was my total pleasure. I guess if I had a question at all, it would be to ask you both, how, or maybe all of you really, how the community work you've done has affected the individual work you do. Do you play the clarinet differently, Louise? Does it affect your composition, Giorgio? Rebecca, do you take time to do individual work, or is all your work in a communal collective way?
I think my work as a creative artist, like, it is very intertwined with the work that I do in community, because what I do as an artist is very participatory. Even if I'm the only one on stage, as an example, I've got a solo album that's coming up out in the spring, and Giorgio is really loving your description of how you're going to sonify the city of Vancouver, because I'm going to launch the album as an outdoor installation in which people will be able to do a treasure hunt for QR codes that are little tiny bird calls that I play on the clarinet. But it'll be like there'll be an installation going on at the same time, but then depending on how many people are around and how many people get excited about the QR codes, it could be a whole entire forest worth of birds. So even though that may be, sort of me, Louise Campbell, as the artist, it's still got other people involved in it. And that's the most me as an artist that I go. Everything else is on a spectrum of having more people involved than just me. So I can't separate the two, and I never have. And I only learned to do that a few years ago, once I started to realize that I needed to call myself a composer in order to access some of those systemic, get into some of those systemic, get rid of the barriers for myself, basically. Yeah. Was that if I didn't call myself a composer, then nobody else was going to, and I wasn't going to be able to access funds and opportunities.
You are a composer of sound, a composer of sociality, a composer of community. So yeah, sure, we are absolutely, and you should have all the support that you deserve. And but responding to your question, for me, for example, was, there were two passages in this. One is the coming from Europe with this fresh, curious mind and not knowing anything about Canada, really, and discovering this beautiful country in his own way, and just kind of a change my perspective on many things that influenced my way of thinking. And secondly, being fully engaged after a few years, feeling at home and just be more embodied in my identity in this new place. And I just realized that now from conducting symphonic orchestra to conducting orchestra without any score, which is great. I love that transformation in which, the score is actually everything. And we play in this we actually gonna do it again in January, hopefully. Anyway, we find ourselves in a place where, we just resonate with these large, beautiful instruments and create, and everyone is actually, in a very equal spot. Just a beautiful experience. Not that I don't love Beethoven, but again, I think 51 years later, there is no asset in Beethoven in Canada, in spite of the fact that was one of the first things I was told in a jury, I remember, at the BCR Council, because Beethoven is an asset in Canada. They say, really? When did that happen? I didn't really know. It's not an asset in my country, but in Canada it's an asset. Okay, great. So,
anyway. I know Helen Primer is going to wrap us up very shortly. I'm just going to quickly jump in with my response, Ellen, which is, I have a complex relationship with the idea of being an artist, because a lot of my work disappears. And so finding ways to now acknowledge and talk about creativity that exists in organization, creativity that exists in material resourcing, creativity that exists in arguing with people or working with a nurse on the shift for 6 hours, that is my art practice, and that is where it lives. And there is also sound, and there is also image, and there is also all these other things, this theater and this performance, but there is artistic practice in those things. And I feel like we need to own that artistic practice. And it's ones that we can learn a lot from other people who own those practices better than us, I think, in the West. I'll pass back to Helen Primer now, who is going to hopefully wrap us up. But thank you so much. What a great conversation. I'm so inspired by you all. I'm going to go away and be really, really full from our beautiful hanging out.
Likewise. Thank you to you all.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Ellen. Thank you, Rebecca. Thank you
very much to our three panelists, Giorgio, Louise, and Rebecca, and to Rebecca for sort of leading us through that very inspiring conversation. We also need to thank a big hearty thanks to Factor, who supported this series of conversations. And just while I have you here, I want to remind you that the next CNNN conversation is on January the 18th, which is National Indigenous Day. And the theme for that conversation is Indigenous Resurgence. So you'll be getting some reminders about that closer to the time, but put it in your calendar, and we hope to see you at that one as well. Again, great thanks to our group of inspiring panelists, and thank you to those who are listening today. And we will sign off and have a great evening or thank afternoon, you. Wherever you happen to be.
Thank you, everyone. Great thank to see you all.
Bye-bye.
Bye.